You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys on Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hickey.
Good Monday morning. Welcome into the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It is the Morning Boys right here with you on this gorgeous Monday morning. Hopefully, wherever you are, you had a great weekend, enjoyable. You stayed safe. You stayed sane, and we appreciate you starting yet another week as we creep closer to the end of August. And unfortunately, that means closer to the end of summertime as we begin here the last week of August. It is crazy, really crazy. Now that you think about it, 2020 at the same time has been the longest year, I feel like, and also it's gone the quickest. I mean, we're almost 9 months in. Feels like, you know, from some aspects, the coronavirus that started in March feels like, you know, happened 3 years ago, right? Like March feels like an eternity. We're right on the edge of the NCAA basketball tournament. Obviously, you know, all the other sports were going. I always had a Super Bowl. And all of a sudden, it felt like in the blink of an eye, everything got, you know, everything changed. Everything didn't go, you know, obviously got changed from being a normal life to what we are now. The new normal, we'll call it. And in some aspects, I feel like, you know, especially the summertime, you blink and it's already over. Really, really weird so far. We'll see how these last 4 months shape up. But it's been, at the same time, as weird as it is to say, it's kind of a very quick 2020, but also a very, very, very long in some aspects 2020. So, again, we appreciate you joining us here on this last week of August. Before we get going here, it is both the end of an era and the start of a new era. So really excited to say that this will be the last show titled The Morning Boys with Ryan Hickey, and that will end this week and starting a week from today, next Monday, because I'm off on Thursday. Thanks partly to the Big Ten not playing any football, my yearly pilgrimage to State College, beautiful State College, hanging out with a few college buddies, cannot happen this fall. So instead, we're going to move it up to the summertime. So that's where we'll be on Thursday. So no show on Thursday, but this time next week, next Monday, we will launch the brand new Ryan Hickey Show right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Same time, Monday and Thursdays, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Same host, yourself, you know, yours truly, Ryan Hickey here. But really excited to kind of launch that into the stratosphere and do a lot on social media as well with the show. So very excited. The Morning Boys will be no more, but alas, the show will still be here. It'll be the Ryan Hickey Show moving forward starting a week from today. So very, very, very excited about that. Also, speaking of exciting, there's no other word to say. Exciting is the perfect word. Luka Doncic. Really, there's only one word to describe him. And that was exciting. If you watched any of his action this week so far in the Mavericks series against the Clippers, it's been incredible. And topped off last night with just an incredible 43-point buzzer-beater game-winning three to even the series at two between the Clippers and the Mavericks. And I do want to discuss Luka's ascension, because I think he has the tools to rise to a level that we've seen only a few players rise to. And he could take the torch from someone. I want to discuss that in just a second here, but I want to give you the rest of the lineup so far. So Luka's great. Incredible, incredible, incredible performance last night. I do want to kind of dive into that a little more. But also I kind of want to stick with the NBA, because an interesting article came out last week by Ethan Strauss of The Athletic. And he detailed the NBA ratings. And he detailed not just this year at the ratings, not just the last calendar year at the ratings. He's gone back the last 8 years, going back to the 2011-2012 season, and the numbers are very low, and they are staggering, staggeringly low. So I want to ask the question, is the NBA, in your mind, still nationally relevant? Right? We know the NFL is the most nationally relevant sport in the country. Baseball had that for a while. Hockey, for the most part, has always been kind of contained to whatever market you're in. If you're in a market that has a team that's passionate about it, for the most part, that's where the most interest is drawn, in that local market to your local team. But we always kind of put the NBA up there with the NFL. Never equal, but we do say, okay, the NFL is obviously the most important, the sport that's cared about the most. We always put NBA second. I want to kind of discuss, you know, is the NBA, should they be second? Are they actually a national sport? And if you're not watching, I'm very curious as to why. We'll do that in 9:20, just about 15 minutes or so from now. Nick Nurse wins Coach of the Year award over the weekend. Congratulations to him, the head coach of the Raptors. Is he the best coach currently right now in the NBA? A lot of great coaches out there. Greg Popovich, you know, obviously the great Steve Kerr, Doc Rivers, Eric Spoelstra, I think is another great coach down there in Miami. Is he the best coach right now in the NBA? We'll discuss that at 9:40. Top of the second hour. 10 o'clock Eastern. The Ravens cut Earl Thomas. Two things. One that super really, really, really annoyed me about how the process went about. And another thing, too, because we talked about this about a month ago. Lamar Jackson made some comments about another play, about Antonio Brown. And I want to play you for those comments again, just to refresh your memory and show you why how the Ravens just handled Earl Thomas. What happened here in cutting a player they signed to a big four-year, $55 million deal just last year, a guy who made the Pro Bowl last year for the Ravens, and now they end up cutting him after getting in a fight. I want to show why it proves why Lamar Jackson was wrong in one aspect. We'll do that at 10 o'clock. 10:20. Joe Judge has got a lot of attention, head coach of the New York Giants recently, for his, let's say, interesting tactics, his different tactics. If you want to say a Belichickian style so far to coaching. Will it work? Will it stick? We'll tell you what he's doing. It's definitely something I'm sure you really haven't heard of, a lot of. And we'll see if it'll work with the Giants. And finally, the Sixers are swept. The process is dead. But I do want to talk more about the process overall. Philly, they were able to do the easy part, right? They got the easy part down. Didn't do it great, but they got essentially what they needed to out of tanking. But we'll show you the one fatal flaw. I'll tell you the one fatal flaw that they overlooked severely, and that is keeping them from being a championship-level team. So we'll do that to end the show, 10:40 Eastern. But like I said, no other place to start right now. Insane, insane, insane playoffs so far for the Mavericks star, Luka Doncic. Another incredible game last night. Going again, another incredible game, I should say, against a Clippers team that prides itself on defense, that has great defenders, lengthy, rangy, athletic defenders in Paul George, in Kawhi Leonard, in really throughout their entire team. They pride themselves on defense. That is their really founding principle. And that's how they are built. But yet again, last night, Luka Doncic, 43 points, 17 rebounds, and 13 assists. Joins Michael Jordan as the only player to at least score 40 points in a playoff series and then hit the buzzer beater while trailing to win the game. Not to mention, let's just keep the accolades coming. Youngest player to record a 40-point playoff triple-double, of course, at 21 years old. And, by the way, doing all this, having all the success, hitting that game-winning three in overtime on a sprained ankle and without his running mate, Kristaps Porzingis. Two minor details. You know, he missed a lot of game three when he turned that ankle. Looked pretty bad. Couldn't put any weight on it. And then just before game four, Kristaps Porzingis scratched, sore right knee, didn't play. Really, the 1-2 punch with Luka and KP, didn't play, and that's okay. Put the team on his back. Led the Mavericks, a young team, a feisty team, and was able to, again, now even the series at two games apiece with the Clippers team. Now, at least for me, last week, if you heard the show, they are my finals favorite. They are the team I have above the Lakers, I have above the Bucks, and above everybody else as the favorite to win the finals right now down in the bubble. So I want to kind of discuss Luka himself, Luka the player, and what we're going on. Because he's, again, 21 years old. Second year in the league, there is a lot of potential still there. So I'll ask this question. What is his ceiling? Because to me, you watch not only just this game yesterday, you watch kind of his first 2 years in the league, how he's developed, how he's carried himself, what his skill set is like. There is potential, and it's not outlandish, to start talking about him being the guy to take the torch from LeBron James as the greatest player in the NBA, just like LeBron did when he got to his peak, taking over from Michael Jordan. Right, for the most part, every decade kind of has their player that stamps their legacy is the guy to beat. And we've had LeBron James now for two decades, really, be that guy, and obviously be in the conversation for greatest player of all time. But Luka, again, 2 years in, so there's still a lot we don't know, and a lot of room for improvement, by the way. But to me, he possesses two real key traits in his game already that could put him, and it already does put him on the path, to take that torch from LeBron whenever LeBron retires. 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, however long. You know, LeBron has talked about trying to play with his son. So maybe he's around for, you know, four, five, 6 more years. Who knows? We'll see with LeBron. But the point is right now, I think Luka's the guy in an NBA, in a league filled with a lot of young talent, a lot of transcendent, exciting players coming up, having success. To me, Luka, again, the two traits he has to really kind of be on that track to take over LeBron. Number one is skill set. And again, he is 21 years old. This is his second year in the NBA. But already, he has a smooth three-point shot. And we saw that yesterday a lot. with him drilling threes over the Clippers. He can drive to the basket. He's a solid mid-range game. His step-back jumper is incredible. But not just that, not just his ability to score. Because we have a lot of players in the NBA that can do that. Devin Booker is a guy that can score any night. Whoever's on him, he could score. We see Donovan Mitchell now going off. Two 50-point games in one series for Donovan Mitchell with the Jazz. There is a ton of young talent that can score. But here's what I'm talking about with the skill set. His passing skills, Luka's passing skills already, 2 years in, are impeccable. Incredible. His vision on the court, his ability to drive in, suck the defense in, and know, while doing that, which guy's going to be open. Guy in the corner. Maybe it's up at the top of the key. Maybe it's on the wing. It's all calculated with him. And this is skills that a 21-year-old shouldn't have. And since we're talking about LeBron, since we're talking about Luka taking the torch potentially from LeBron, what if we look at LeBron? I mean, let's just not pretend he came into the league and was automatically the greatest player right then and there. He was still very raw. His passing skills the first 4, 5, 6 years with the Heat, with the Cavaliers, weren't anywhere close to what Luka's skills are right now. Remember how long it took LeBron James to get a solid and consistent jump shot, let alone three-pointer? I mean, it really took him to getting to the Heat for him to actually refine and get a consistent jump shot where he was a threat. Because that was really the way to guard LeBron for his first tenure in Cleveland. He is massive. He is athletic as hell. So he can beat you on the dribble. He can body you down low. So if LeBron got ahead of steam, you're in trouble. But the thing with LeBron was, if you made him settle for jump shots, if you kept him on the outside, he would struggle. He couldn't consistently knock down the shot. But that's not the case already with Luka. Already, Luka Doncic has a consistent jump shot, can hit it from anywhere on the floor, consistently shooting threes, is a real threat from the outside, and creates his own shot. Not to mention, again, his passing skills, his vision on the court already for a player 2 years in the league, are impeccable. So he already has a massive advantage at his age than LeBron did when he was 21. Now again, one thing Luka will never have that LeBron has is that extreme athleticism. Right? LeBron is 6'9", essentially a linebacker with incredible speed. He can body centers. He can blow by guards. He has a skill set and a body that is one in a million. Never be duplicated. And that allows him to have certain skills that cannot, you know, that other players just can't possess. But you look at the real talent already. 2 years in, Luka has LeBron beat. He has LeBron beat. So the skill set to me, having the overall skill set, right? Because again, there's a lot of great young players that can score, that are just pure scorers, that can get their shot, that can drill a three, that can drive to the hole. But it's the other skills. It's the passing. It's the vision that make the difference so far at this young age. Two, the other skill set I think he has, that, or the other trait, I should say, excuse me, Luka has so far, is his mindset. And this is the perfect example. This series alone is the perfect example of the strong-willed mindset that winners have. He doesn't get rattled. He doesn't get intimidated. He doesn't let players get in his head. Because essentially already, that's what the Clippers have been trying to do. You had Montrezl Harrell say some things he shouldn't have said. They got into it in Game 3. It got chippy. And what happened in Game 4? Luka comes back, and especially in the big moments in the fourth quarter in overtime, makes shot after shot after shot. And what does he do after that, making that shot? Stares right at the Clippers bench. Stares right into their soul and says, someone stop me. Because right now, no one is. Staring, think about that. A 21-year-old. Going against a team filled with veterans, a team with veterans that have championship experience. We have Doc Rivers as the coach, incredible pedigree championship coach. Kawhi Leonard, I mean, two-time finals MVP. Best two-way player in the league. Paul George, obviously extremely skilled and talented. You have this Clippers core, you know, have great playoff experience last year, have great rapport. Very, you know, very experienced. And here he is dissecting, no matter who's on him, dissecting his defense, scoring at will, and then letting them know about it. I'm here. Someone stop me. So again, having that, you know, that killer mindset where someone gets under his skin, he uses that motivation. Kind of like Michael Jordan. Obviously, again, not at the same level. But it's like if someone wrongs him, or if they want to really, you know, get intense, he'll get intense and he'll play better. We've seen players kind of try to do too much. They get overzealous. They try to take every shot. They try to make every, you know, play hero ball, essentially, play one versus five to try to stick a point to it's a player, a coach, a team. And sometimes that, you know, that's to the detriment of the overall team. They don't get the win. Now, we kind of saw with Russell Westbrook in OKC. Kevin Durant leaves, goes to the Warriors. Russell Westbrook feels hurt. And instead, now he kind of, to take his anger out or maybe to show that Kevin Durant made the wrong decision, he played hero ball. Get every rebound, make the assists, score as many points as possible. Obviously, had the most triple-doubles in NBA history for a season. Won the MVP. But look how far the Thunder got. Eliminated in the first round. Sometimes that anger, that motivation that players have could be to the detriment of the team. But instead, Luka channels it for good. Makes the team around him better. Takes his game to the next level. Again, not to mention, mindset-wise, two built-in excuses were already there for him. We didn't even know if he was going to play. It was a game-time decision for Game 4. Right? That was a scary injury he had in Game 3. We weren't sure what his health was going to be, what the health of his ankle is. So you could have blamed a bad game on that. And again, his 1-2 punch, the second player, Kristaps Porzingis, out. And out right before the game. You're not supposed, you know, the Mavericks aren't supposed to be in this series anyway. Let alone when you miss one of your best players. So the mindset, the skill set for me are the two traits that Luka possesses at just 21 years old, just his second year in the league. That's why he's on the path right now, I believe. Take that torch from LeBron James whenever LeBron James retires, steps out of the limelight, and Luka Doncic, the phenom down in Dallas, the star, is poised to be the next face of the NBA. There's a lot of young talent, like I said. Jason Tatum. You have Trae Young, obviously, in that big trade with the Hawks. Devin Booker, who I mentioned. John Morant, Zion Williamson. There's a ton of young talent up and coming this league. Look at all those guys. To me, Luka already has the most polished, versatile skill set of anyone. And part of the reason why LeBron James elevated to the best player in the game and one of the best players overall in NBA history is because of that overall skill set for his shooting, for his driving, for his defense, for his passing, for his vision on the court, for his mental status. All elite. I think Luka right now is on the path to greatness, and he is on the path right now to be the best player in the NBA in a few years. So I'm curious your thoughts. You watched the game yesterday. Were you impressed? Were you blown away? Is this your first time watching Luka Doncic play? Love to get your thoughts. An incredible, incredible game. And so far, an incredible series going on. Again, we are tied 2 games apiece with Game 5 on Tuesday night. And just, you know, maybe you want to talk about the Mavericks overall. Because they look dangerous right now. So the Mavericks dangerous. Can they have a chance in the playoffs? And what are your thoughts? Can Luka Doncic be the next LeBron James? Can he be the guy to take the torch and be the next face of the league? Be the next best player in the NBA. So we'll get your thoughts. Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Facebook. If you want to tweet us, WWSRN_radio, WWSRN_radio, or comment on Facebook again, Worldwide Sports Radio Network, comment under the video that is live, and we will read your thoughts on the air. And when we come back, I do want to stick with the NBA, because Ethan Strauss wrote an interesting article about the NBA ratings. Nationally, just specifically nationally, the ratings are down a ton. We'll tell you the numbers. And is the NBA truly a national relevant sport? I want to get your thoughts, because you are the viewer. So let's get your thoughts when the Morning Boys, Ryan Hickey, return right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys. On Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hickey. Ryan Hickey.
And we are back here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network on this Monday morning, reacting to the incredible, incredible, incredible performance by Mavs sensation, phenom, star, unicorn, whatever you want to call him, Luka Doncic. 43 points, including the game-winning three, as the Mavericks even up and tie their series with the Clippers at two games apiece. He's been phenomenal. Set the record for most points scored in your first career playoff game, 40, I believe it was 40. Followed that up with the most points scored in your first two games of your playoff career, totaled 70, and now follows that up with a 43-point, and again, game-winning shot to even the series at two games by Luka Doncic. We're talking about, I think for me, he's on the path to the greatness. Stardom. And when I say greatness, excuse me, I'm talking about LeBron James level. I'm not talking about Kevin Durant or Dwayne Wade or, you know, a lot of these great, great elite players, but never kind of on their own. Like LeBron James is one in a million. He's on his own. No one's in the same class. Michael Jordan, same thing. Luka Doncic. 2 years in the league, just 21 years old. Can score, can pass, has great vision. To me, he's on that path. He's on that right track to get there. Where in a few years, when LeBron James eventually hangs it up, his play deteriorates, and he's no longer the greatest player in the NBA. To me, Luka is primed right now. Ahead of guys like Jason Tatum, ahead of guys like Devin Booker, Trae Young, Zion Williamson, John Morant, he is prime right now, has a skill set and a mindset to be that guy. So I'd love to get your thoughts. If you agree or disagree, either one. Well, I'd love to get your thoughts. Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Easy for me to say. Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Facebook. While you're there, throw us a like. That way you get a notification every single time a show goes live. And if you haven't noticed, if you haven't thrown us a like or you have, first of all, thank you. Second of all, you notice there's a ton of content, a ton of shows on our network now. Really anything you want. You're a Jets fan. We have a Jets show Sunday night. Also, Great Hour Mark, president of this Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Big Jets fan. He hosts the show Down to the Wire. Mondays, 6:30. Below the Mic, Thursdays, 6:30. Hosts an MMA wrestling show on Fridays. Whatever you're into sports-wise, we have it covered right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. So you shoot us a like on Facebook. You get a notification every time a show goes live. You follow us on Twitter, same thing, WWSRN_radio. You can watch a show live. You can keep up with all the content, keep up with all the shows that go on through Periscope, through our Twitter. And if you haven't done so yet, you're missing out big time. Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Android, WWSRN on iOS. Download the app, and that way, too, it's a one-stop shop. Every show we do, every article that's written, every blog post, every clip, every YouTube clip, every clip of the show that goes throughout our various social media platforms can all be found in one-stop shopping, one area, and that is the Worldwide Sports Radio Network app. Again, WWSRN on iOS, Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Android. Download it. It will make your life so much easier to where anytime you want to read something, you want to listen to a show, go back, maybe re-listen to a segment you missed. You can do that all in one place, Worldwide Sports Radio Network app. WWSRN on iOS again, WWSRN on iOS, Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Android. So like I said, we are talking Luka Doncic. We are talking basketball here. But I want to kind of put a different turn on it. I really want to get your opinion and your thoughts because you, the viewer, you, the listener right now to this show, I'm assuming for the most part, are a sports fan. Because you consume whatever sports you like, right? You watch games, you watch, whether it's your only, you know, your local team that you like, maybe it's only football and baseball you like, maybe it's hockey and basketball, whatever. But you're a sports fan in some aspect. So I'm really curious your thoughts, because for me, my thoughts are almost irrelevant on this topic. Because I want to talk about the NBA ratings and whether the sport itself is still nationally relevant. Nathan Strauss of The Athletic wrote a very interesting and great article this week, or last week, I should say, excuse me, about the NBA ratings. And he didn't just, you know, kind of only talk about this year's ratings from October to March before the shutdown. Didn't talk about the last year and a half's ratings or the bubble ratings. No, no, no. He went back 8 years, back to the lockout 2011-2012 season. And he looked at the national rating, the ratings for the national televised games, right? So ABC, TNT, and ESPN. When those are usually national games and they're usually big-time matchups. Ethan found out and wrote about how the ratings for NBC are down 45% in that eight-year window. TNT's ratings are down 40% in that same eight-year gap, and ESPN's are down 20%. So 45% for ABC, 40% for TNT, 20% for ESPN now in 2019, 2020, compared to 2011, 2012, so 8 years. So in 8 years, the national ABC NBA audience has almost been cut in half. Same with TNT. Think about that. 40% and 45% drop is almost half of your viewers are gone in that eight-year window. Now, local ratings are down. But it's interesting. I want to talk about this on more of a national level because it's not every sport, right? Because if it was every sport, okay. That's one thing, right? Ratings are down everywhere. Maybe it's because the technology hasn't caught up to cord cutting. Maybe it's because the technology hasn't really kind of taken into account the social media presence that, you know, a lot of fans now are charting to watch their games and engage with teams and players that way. But in that same span, so that same eight-year span where ABC is down 45%, TNT is down 40%, and ESPN is down 20%. In that same eight-year window, both the NFL and MLB have essentially stayed the same. Their ratings are down like 0.1%, but essentially they have stayed stagnant. So the ratings for the NFL and MLB in 2012, the ratings for NFL and MLB today are essentially the same for their nationally televised games, right? So for Sunday Night Baseball, for the ESPN MLB broadcasts, for the NFL, obviously, you know, the Fox, CBS, Sunday Night Football, Monday Night Football, Thursday Night Football. We're talking about just nationally broadcasted games. NFL and MLB have stayed the same. Basketball on ABC has dropped 45%, TNT down 40%. So I'm curious, are you the sports fan? You? Because me, you know, doing this as a living, making really sports my passion, my career, I'm watching no matter what. You know, I'm one of their P1 viewers. Baseball, I'm watching. NFL, I'm watching. NBA, I'm watching. This is just part of my job. So I'm watching no matter what. But you have a choice, right? You do, you watch whatever you want. This is leisure. Sports are leisure, and that's what they're meant to be. So if you don't want to watch an NBA game between the Warriors and the Sixers, if you're a Knicks fan, you don't have to. No one's forcing you to. You can watch something else. So that's why I'm curious at your thoughts specifically on if the NBA is so nationally relevant, because these numbers say no. Losing half your viewership in 8 year span is not good. Losing 40% on TNT, your other big, massive NBA partner, is not good while the NFL and MLB stay the same. Viewers aren't watching less sports. They're watching sports. Just they're not watching the NBA. So I'm curious why. And you look at, you know, the actual amount of viewers themselves, right? We knew the NBA wasn't anywhere close. The NFL, it's on its own. And we're talking the four major sports. We're talking about the relevancy and what we talk about. Football is king. So football averages 16 million viewers for every national broadcast. Well, MLB, NHL, and NBA are way, way, way down the list. And at least, I don't know about you, but for me, I always thought the NBA was comfortably in second. Oh, so it's the NFL 1, the NBA 2, and then way more down there be MLB and the NHL. Just two sports that for whatever reason struggle to get national relevant attention, but in their respective markets are very popular. But for whatever reason, again, nationally, people are tuning into national games to watch a Dodgers-Giants game if you're a Yankees fan. Not many people are doing so, but the NFL, obviously, no matter what fan you are, you're watching the big games. But the NBA is a lot closer to MLB's ratings than the NFL. So the NFL got 16 million viewers on average during this time for nationally televised games. MLB averaged 2.4 million. So obviously, I mean, massive, massive, massive gap. But the NBA is just above MLB. They're basically averaging 2.95 million viewers this past year for national broadcasts. So I always thought it was the NFL, dropped down a few tiers, the NBA, dropped down a bunch more tiers, MLB. It's the NFL. Way, 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 way down here is the NBA. Right below them is the MLB. So I'm curious your thoughts. Again, I would love to know if you're not watching, why? Because it sounds like, and it looks like, according to Ethan Strass in this article, half of ABC's national viewing experience for NBA is gone. So half of you, wherever you're listening to, have stopped watching basically national NBA games. You could still be a big fan of your local team. I'm a Knicks fan, right? Try to watch as many Knicks games as possible. I also watch a lot of the national games. Again, I hate sports. It's what I do. But if you're a Knicks fan, if you're a Lakers fan, a Bucks fan, or whatever fan, if you're only watching your team and don't really care about the rest of the league, well, then the NBA is not nationally relevant as we thought, which I'm curious about, because now especially I feel like the NBA is more relevant. They have everything there to make them nationally relevant, to make us care about the players, about the games, about the drama, closer to the NFL level than the baseball level. There's really three things to me the NBA has right now in 2019, 2020, in this day and age, that makes them nationally relevant, that I view them as nationally relevant, but the ratings, again, are cratering. Number one, I just mentioned it, drama. We love drama. There's a reason why the Kardashians are still a very popular TV show, despite the fact that it's literally a show only about their lives. Because there's drama. There's always something going on. Well, it's the same thing with the NBA. There was always some sort of drama, always some sort of storyline, some sort of beef that gets blown up that we pay attention to, sometimes more than the actual games themselves. So whether it's Kyrie Irving not wanting to play with LeBron, throwing shade at his Celtics teammates, Kevin Durant obviously kind of being always upset and kind of being very shady with the media. There's always some sort of drama going on. There's always some sort of storyline outside of the game that makes it interesting. There's always some sort of beef that we're watching that goes down on social media, that goes down in post-game press conferences, that makes watching that next matchup between those two teams worth it. Not to mention, you have so many star players going from team to team to team, more than we really see in any other sport. That's drama in and of itself, right? In this span, in the eight-year span where Ethan Strauss is citing a 45% drop for ABC, you had LeBron, he was on the Heat, he left, goes to the Cavaliers, left them, goes to the Lakers. The superstar, the face of the NBA, has been on three different teams in those 8 years. And he's not the only one. They had Kevin Durant leave the Thunder to go to the Warriors. Left the Warriors to go to the Nets. AD, obviously we know how that entire situation played out down in New Orleans. Wanted to go to the Lakers. LeBron's agent, also AD's agent, trying to make some noise. That drama unfolds publicly between the Lakers and the Pelicans franchise. Eventually AD gets to the Lakers. But there's a ton of drama there, a ton of storylines there before we end up got to that point. Kawhi Leonard, Paul George, again, players that have been on different teams multiple times during this time. So a ton of drama. More drama probably in any other league. So the NBA has the storylines, has the drama to be nationally relevant that we love, right? We, the viewer, love drama. Not to mention the product on the court is more exciting than ever. Right? More ball movement. Better passing. Better shooting. The game is more wide open. The athleticism of the players have improved. So the game's only getting better. The shots are getting wilder. The shots are getting deeper. Look at Steph and Dame Lillard just constantly basically having a contest with themselves to see who can pull up from the farthest and drain it. I mean, you have Damian Lillard now essentially pulling up from just inside half court and making it at an incredible clip. So the range of these players is getting better. Like I said, the ball movement, the passing, the pace, transition offense is used more than ever. So it's a fast-paced, exciting game. Again, the athleticism has improved, so these players are getting bigger, faster, stronger, which makes what they're able to do at the basketball more impressive. So you have drama. To me, the product on the court is very, very, very exciting. And not to mention, the biggest key is that they have an incredibly large social media presence. Highlights all over social media, which is the biggest thing that MLB has failed to do. And one of my big contention points with them as to why they've kind of fallen behind the NFL, fallen behind the NBA, is that they are awful at social media. But the NBA is great at it. The highlights, boom. Luka Doncic hits that three yesterday. Within 2 minutes, I saw five different videos of it. So the highlights are all over social media. The players themselves have a big-time social media presence, a ton of followers. They post a lot of stuff on there. It's not really coach speak or athlete speak. Right? They are not afraid to say what they think. China goes back into the drama aspect of point one. which makes it exciting, which makes it entertaining, which makes these players a must-follow. So for me, to have a massive and popular social media presence, to actually have the product on the court, the actual games themselves, be more excited than ever, and to have drama out the wazoo, that, to me, makes the NBA a nationally relevant sport still. Still cements itself strongly behind the NFL in my mind at number two. But according to the rings, that's not the case. ABC, again, has lost half its viewership the last 8 years. So I'm curious to you, if you're not watching the NBA, why not? Why not? Because at least for me, again, obviously working in sports, it's a little different. It's part of my job to watch these games. And, you know, so it's different. It's part of the job. But I'll say this. My interest in basketball has only grown the last 8 years. I didn't grow up in a basketball household. Myself, like I'm sure many sports fans, you know, you watch the teams that your dad grows up watching. So being a Mets fan, you know, being a Colts fan, those are really the two main sports, football and baseball, that you grow up watching. Big Notre Dame fan, so I was a big Notre Dame fan growing up. But basketball never really, you know, we watch a lot of college basketball, never really the NBA. So I didn't grow up in an NBA household. But, you know, as I, you know, start watching more sports, as I kind of got into it, I've appreciated the game a lot more. So my appreciation and my excitement for the game right now has really never been higher, which I guess is bucking the trend in the complete opposite how a lot of you feel. So I'm curious because, again, we've always kind of put the NBA, always assume they're nationally relevant, always assumes that no matter where you are, what market you are, Miami, Milwaukee, Utah, Portland, wherever you were, you had some sort of interest in whatever the big game is going on. You cared if you're in Portland what the Clippers or what the Lakers or what the Suns were doing or the Warriors. We assumed that similar to the NFL, you put any big-time matchup on a nationally televised game, people would watch. But that's not been the case according to these numbers. Again, a 45% dip for ABC in the last 8 years. TNT down 40%. ESPN down 20%. While at the same time, again, the NFL and the Major League Baseball in the same exact time period, from 2012 to now, their ratings have stayed the same. Stayed the same. So people are still watching baseball the same amount that they were 8 years ago. People are still watching football the same amount that they were 8 years ago, but they're watching a lot less basketball. And I'm curious why. I really am curious why. I'd love to get your thoughts because, again, my thoughts honestly are relevant for this conversation. I'm one of those guys that always watches. I will always watch. So they already have me, per se. But they're always chasing new fans. They're always trying to be nationally relevant. So if you're not watching the NBA, I'm very curious as to why not. Why not? I don't know if it's the style of play. Now, a lot of the shows I worked on this weekend at CBS Sports Radio did the same sort of topic. And a lot of callers called in. I thought it was interesting. I'll give you a few reasons that were listed. Pace of play, or I'll show you the style of play. Too many threes. Fans didn't like the amount of three-point shooting. I disagree. I think it's more exciting. I think it opened up the court more because, again, you really want to go back. We all watched The Last Dance. We all saw, especially for me, it was great insight to see what 90s basketball was like with you know, with a lot of these like you know videos taken from the court. A lot of defense, a lot of physicality. So these games were really low scoring. I truly think if we went back to those rules, if we played baseball, if we played basketball like it was in the 80s, a lot of people would complain. It would be a slog. It wouldn't be exciting. It would be a grind just to score points, and people would get tired of it. Another issue, too much politics. Whether it's players taking a stance and what's going on with the bubble, whether it's coaches speaking out. What I don't get is, though, this is an eight-year trend. Politics, for the most part, were the last to enter the NBA actually on the court. Right? NFL was the first sport we saw players kneel for the anthem back in 2016. No one ever kneeled in the NBA for the anthem. And outside of a few nights where the you know players and teams were, I can't breathe shirts before the game, Clippers did their demonstrations when Donald Sterling made his disgusting comments. But for the most part, up until really the restart, there wasn't many politics actually during the game. You had coaches like Steve Kerr, Greg Popovich speaking out in press conferences, Steve Kerr speaking out on social media. But politics never really entered the actual game when you're actually watching the game. So to be honest, I think that's a convenient excuse that I'm not really sure flies right now. Or I should say, not flies, that's the wrong way. I should say, not enough of an excuse to justify almost a 50% fall in ratings. And we were talking about half the audience shutting out nationally televised games. So again, I'm curious your thoughts. Do you watch the NBA? If your answer is no, I'm very, very, very curious as to why. I would love to know why. And should we start now considering the NBA to be a regional sport? The NBA, I think, has tried their best to be on the same level as the NFL. I think they realize they're not on the same level, but they've tried in terms of national relevancy to get to that same level, get to that same height. Where no matter what game or what team you're a fan of, you care about a Tuesday night Lakers-Bucks game. So far, the ratings have shown that's just not the case. So is it time we consider the NBA in the same realm as the MLB and the NHL? So I'm curious your thoughts, please. If you're an NBA fan, if you're not watching, I would love to know why. Any reason is fine. I'm genuinely curious. So this is a topic where my opinion is pointless. I'm going to watch no matter what, but a lot of the average fans, or maybe just a lot of big NBA fans, are not watching anymore. So I'm curious why. Reach out on Facebook, World Wide Sports Radio Network, Twitter, WWSRN. You want to tweet me personally, Ryan_Hickey3. Ryan_Hickey3 will take your thoughts. Why aren't you watching the NBA? Is it us just miscalculating the NBA's reach? Is it really a regional sport? I say no. I think it's still nationally relevant. I still think it's solidly in second place behind the NFL. But the ratings say different. The ratings do say different. So I'm very curious your thoughts. We'll get your thoughts. If the NBA, if you're not watching, why not? And when we come back, who is the best coach in the NBA? Is it crazy to say it's a man in his second year in the league as a head coach? We'll discuss next. It is the Morning Boys, Ryan Hickey, right here on the World of Sports Radio Network.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys. On Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hickey.
And we're rolling along here on a beautiful Monday morning, wherever you are. Hopefully the weather's the same. You're doing great. Had a great weekend, I should say. Staying safe and staying sane. And we do welcome you and thank you for joining, can't even talk today, starting your week with us right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Sad, sad, sad reminder, by the way. Seeing Andrew Luck trend on Twitter as August 24th, 2019, Andrew Luck announces sudden retirement from the NFL. As a Colts fan myself, as someone who had Super Bowl aspirations last year with this team, I was shocked is a word. Were you shocked? I think numb. Took a very long time. I still remember where I was when I got the news. Thinking, of all people, by the way, the first person to tell me that Andrew Luck retired was my sister. She was on, I believe it was Facebook, and said, oh, look, Barstool Sports is reporting that Andrew Luck retired. And I thought she got duped. I'm like, oh, what an idiot. You know, it's just like a joke. Like, you fell for it. And all of a sudden, I don't know what it was, because all of a sudden I went from no messages at the same time, like 5 minutes later after the news broke, to like 30 messages. Mostly, of course, not nice ones. Or ones, I should say, not expressing sympathy for the loss. Yeah, that was a tough one for sure. That was obviously, you never expect a player in the prime of their career with the talent that Andrew Luck had, with the skill set around him that the Colts had, that a player would suddenly retire. But that's wild. And honestly, it doesn't feel like a year ago. And If you told me it was 5 years ago, I would have believed it. Wow. Well, we talk about 2020 being one of the longest and shortest years, if that makes sense, at the same time. 1 year ago, honestly, feels like 10 years ago. Like, I think this year, 2020, has aged everyone like dog years. Right? What is it? One year in human life is 7 years. 7 years in dog life. It feels like the same. And that's just the thing. That's just the, you know, that's how it. Seeing this Andrew Luck news 1 year ago today makes you feel the same exact way. I hear you there. But yeah, like we just were saying, it's sorry about that. It is a weird year, and again, feels very, very long in some aspects and gone very, very quickly. But crazy thing, just 1 year ago today, Andrew Luck retired. So much has gone on. Doesn't feel like that at all. So like I said, we're talking a lot of the NBA. If you're a fan of the NBA, or more importantly, I should say, if you're not a fan of the NBA, if you stopped watching. Because right now, again, we just discussed an Ethan Strauss article from The Athletic. The ABC national televised NBA ratings back from 2011-2012 to now have dropped 45%. TNT's ratings have dropped 40%. So I'm curious, is the NBA nationally relevant in your mind? Do you care about teams that aren't yours? Do you care about the NBA in general overall? Do you still watch the league? I thought for a long time the NBA was in second place, but was significantly ahead of baseball, of hockey, and not that far behind football. It was a gap, but I didn't think it was as wide as it is right now. Because the ratings bear out that fans are not watching the NFL, or excuse me, not watching the NBA, anywhere near the same as they're watching the NFL. Not even close. So I'm curious, if you're not watching the NBA anymore, why? So again, Facebook, World of Sports and Eric, Twitter, WWSRN_radio. Get your thoughts. And also some quick NBA, some quick NFL news, some more good news. If you watched, or excuse me, if over the weekend you saw some news about a ton of positive tests for the Bears, for the Jets, for the Giants, for the Bills. Good news. There wasn't a sudden outbreak in the NFL. Where almost it felt like almost a third of the league or a quarter of the league was affected. There was all false positive tests from one of the labs that they used in New Jersey. The official ruling now, 77 presumptive positive tests that came back over the weekend as positive actually were false positive and they ended up being negative. So scary, or at least I guess I should say the challenge that the NFL has in trying to resume, you can do all the things right. Man, you can try to put a bubble as much as possible. You're testing right now every day. You're going to move to every other day if the numbers are low. But even testing a lot, unfortunately, doesn't always guarantee that the results will be accurate. So it's a breath of fresh air, I'm sure, sorry for the NFL, that all these tests that came back positive were actually negative. So I know teams like the Browns had altered their practice schedule, same thing with the Bears. But a bunch of different teams that all use the same lab in New Jersey, who all got positive tests against 77 over the weekend, came back positive. All were false positives, and thankfully are all negatives. So it's a learning opportunity for the NFL, of course. It shows just the variance and truly how hard it is to pull off a sport with close contact during a pandemic. But at least for the NFL, it's good in the sense of two terms. One, obviously no one's sick. That's the best news. No one's sick, no one's at risk, and we could continue on with all these teams getting negative tests and basically ensuring that their training camp bubble has worked so far. But two, at least shows the NFL maybe puts a different protocol in place, or maybe with a change of lab, or you put mechanisms in to prevent all these false positives from coming back. Because what happens if this was Saturday night? These tests came back, 77 were positive. Teams have to maybe completely forfeit. Great players don't play. And then it comes back Monday or Tuesday. Actually, these are false positives. Interesting to see how the league's going to handle that going forward. Again, it's really unfortunate when it's in the hands of the nurses and the doctors and it's in the hands of these labs. There's only so much you can do. But I'm interested to see if the NFL changes the way they attack the testing, they implement protocols. Excuse me. Wow. That came out of nowhere. Because, 77 false positive tests. Really. Definitely a sobering moment for sure, just to show you how hard it is and how tricky it is. If you yourself do all the right things, it is to pull off a season that won't be affected too much by the coronavirus. So, again, good news for the NFL. All tests came back negative or false positives, and everyone is safe going forward. But we'll see if the NFL, because this is going to be a serious issue. That seriously affects competitive integrity, and it affects the season. And if Patrick Mahomes was one of these players who had a positive test on Saturday, doesn't play the game on Sunday, or the Chiefs have to even forfeit the game, take a loss of the schedule, then Monday comes back, actually all these tests were false positives, actually he's negative, I can promise you, it's not going to go over too well than it's going over right now. Right? I'm sure right now, obviously, you know, had Adam Gase talking yesterday saying it's better to happen now than in the season. A lot of these coaches, I'm sure the reaction is sigh of relief. Thank God. Okay, no one's sick. There's no outbreak on the team you have to worry about. But I promise you, in 3 weeks from now, when the season starts, there's going to be even more frustration and more anger than if an outbreak actually did happen. You're canceling games, you're losing games, maybe even losing livelihoods or jobs because the testing isn't maybe as buttoned up as you hoped. So we'll see. We'll see the NFL again. It's definitely a good test run, or I guess it's good in the sense of that it happened now when there's really no harm, no foul. We'll see how the NFL, if they change anything going forward, or how they can try to prevent false positives. I'm not really sure if there's honestly, whether it's different testing, using a different lab, how you kind of go about combating false positive tests. But it's not just, you know, obviously, it's not just a situation that is only affecting the NFL. It's affecting different sports leagues, and obviously me and you in this country trying to get just accurate tests, not the easiest thing to do in the world. So we'll see what the NFL happens. Going forward, good thing that they're all positive. So all those players who thought they had it, thankfully do not. And just a good learning experience for the NFL. So when we come back, sorry, I apologize. We did have a quick segment there. When we come back, who is the best coach currently right now in the NBA? I think it's a guy that's been in the league for 2 years. I'll explain that why when the Morning Boys, Ryan and Key, return right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys on Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hickey.
Hour number two of the Morning Boys program, the last Morning Boys program right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Don't fret. Don't worry. We are going nowhere. But starting a week from Monday, a week from today, the Morning Boys will turn into the Ryan Hickey Show. Very, very, very excited about that. It's a little bit of a new branding, but don't worry. The show will stay the same. The host will stay the same. We'll stay the same hours, Monday, Thursday, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Different name, different title. And with that as well, a little bit different social media presence as well. I'll start a new Twitter account, Ryan Hickey Show, on Twitter and also on Instagram. So Ryan Hickey Show at both. Instagram and Twitter to put clips from the show, to get some thoughts out there, do some instant reaction. So, you know, obviously, we're only on twice a week. And as you know, if you are a listener at any point, really, since we started back in October here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, news tends to break when the show gets off the air immediately, when there's vacation planned, the show is not on its regular time. There's always some sort of breaking news. If we're, let's say, for example, this week, I'm off on Thursday. One last little vacation before the summer ends. So let's just say, you know, since the show's not on Thursday, Wednesday is going to be some breaking news. Wednesday night, especially. So we'll be one of the first to talk about it and give one of the first reactions to whatever news happens. So that's a guarantee. So there's essentially a long-winded way of saying plenty of news breaks when we're not on the air. And when we have a few days before we're back on the air again, give our thoughts. So figure this is a chance to, you know, put some instant reaction videos up. You know, quick little minute, 90-second video of my thoughts that happened. Give you some behind-the-scenes access of how we get to the show, what it's like preparing for it, just whatever's going on in my brain. So Instagram, Ryan Hickey Show. Twitter, Ryan Hickey Show, and that will launch again a week from today. We'll have new imaging. So our great, great, great guy, Brandon, who does the voiceovers, will have a new intro. We'll have a new little different comeback. So everything's going to be a little different, but for the most part, the integrity of the show, everything else with it will stay the same. So very excited again. The Ryan Hickey Show, 1 week from today, right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. So like I said, I teased it last thing. I apologize for not getting to it, so we'll get to it now. Who is the best coach in the NBA? Because over the weekend, the NBA Coach of the Year award was given out. The Raptors head coach Nick Nurse was the recipient. And kind of made me think, is he the best coach currently in the NBA? Because you look at the head coaching roster that's out there right now. Greg Popovich, who's rumored actually to be, you know, the Nets to be interested, so maybe he'll be in Brooklyn coaching KD and Kyrie next year. We have Greg Popovich currently right now in San Antonio. Steve Kerr still out there in Golden State. Eric Spoelstra, I like a lot in Miami, what he's done with that Heat team. Managing the egos with LeBron James, Dwayne Wade, Chris Bosh. Building a team once they left, building them back up into a contender. Mike Budenholzer has really taken Giannis's game and the Bucks to the next level. Doc Rivers is the championship coach. But I do believe, I do think right now, the best coach in the NBA is none of those guys I just listed. It's a guy who is in his second year as a head coach in the NBA, who in his first year won the NBA Finals, second year has his team right back in contention for the NBA Finals, and is doing so with a significantly different piece missing in Kawhi Leonard, and that is Nick Nurse. I do believe right now, currently, Nick Nurse is the best coach in the NBA, and here's why. I just mentioned Kawhi leaving. I went through and thought about it, because I was just so impressed with the way the Raptors have bounced back this year compared to last year, despite the fact that their roster is essentially the same except for one small piece missing. Just, you know, the best two-way player in the NBA, best top five, you know, a top five player in the NBA in Kawhi Leonard leaving. They make a big trade to replace him. They didn't really add anyone to replace Kawhi Leonard. But despite that, their win percentage, because obviously the season being cut short, we can't compare straight up wins to wins, but we'll do instead win percentage. Their win percentage is higher this year, higher than it was last year. And I thought, okay, is this rare? Does this happen a lot? So I went back and looked at a few different teams where superstars left and how they fared the last year that superstar was there and the next year, that first year the superstar was not there. We'll go back to Oklahoma City, easy for me to say. Kevin Durant, when he's there in the final year, right, when they blew that 3-1 lead to the Warriors before Draymond Green makes that call for KD to come join the Warriors, they have 55 wins in KD's final year in Oklahoma City. Year after, Russell Westbrook wins the MVP, 47 wins. So they lost 8 wins when Kevin Durant goes out west to Golden State. Cleveland, they had LeBron James, final year 2017-2018, 55 wins. Now, I mean, they are an extreme case here, but the year after that, LeBron goes to the Lakers. Still most of the team intact. You still had Kevin Love. You still had J.R. Smith. You know, most of the team intact that went to the finals. Now, granted, obviously, LeBron James really put the team on his back, but still, a lot of the surrounding pieces were still there. It wasn't a mass exodus. 19 wins. So Cleveland goes from 55 wins of LeBron last year in 2017-2018 to 19 wins the year after. Miami was sick with LeBron. Right? His last year in Miami, 2013-2014, 54 wins. Goes back home to Cleveland. Next year, they win 37. Almost 20 losses, or 20 wins less, excuse me, for the Heat. LeBron's last year there compared to when the first year that he leaves. Let's look at the Pelicans. Pelicans, that team, Anthony Davis. We'll go back to 2017-2018. That was Anthony Davis's last year that he was healthy, right? Obviously, the last year he was in New Orleans, he gets hurt towards the middle end of the year, trying to force a trade that basically misses the last third of the year. So we'll go to the last full season Anthony Davis played. The Pelicans got 48 wins, 2017-2018. Let's go this year. Again, shortened season, but still they had 30 wins this year. They had 30 wins this year compared to 48 in Anthony Davis's last fully healthy year. How about the Spurs? We're talking about Kawhi Leonard. This is the last one I'll wrap up with. Spurs had 61 wins in 2016-2017, the last year that Kawhi was healthy. 2018-2019, the year Kawhi leaves, he's traded to the Raptors, they go 48 wins. And not to mention, in the year between, when Kawhi basically missed all but 9 games, they had 47 wins. So every case, the Spurs, the Pelicans, the Heat with LeBron, the Cavs with LeBron, Oklahoma City with Kevin Durant, every single case, the wins, the win total from the last year the superstar was there or healthy to the first year the superstar was gone have all decreased. But yet here's Nick Nurse with the Raptors having a better win percentage this year than last year. Despite having the same exact roster as last year, minus a top 5 player in Kawhi Leonard. Incredible. That's an incredible coaching job. Look at their core principle, defense. You had the perfect player in Kawhi Leonard for that defensive system. Two-way player, great offensively, even better defensively. Fit into what Nick Nurse wanted to do perfectly. Despite him leaving, so you think the defense should take a hit. Does not. Second in the NBA, defensive rating. They're higher than the Clippers who got Kawhi. So they have a higher defensive rating than the team Kawhi Leonard went to. And they have a higher defensive rating despite the fact that they lost, again, one of the best two-way players in the game. Not to mention, finally, let's stick with the Raptors roster. They are still winning. They are still second in the East behind the Bucks, and they are still legitimate title contenders despite the fact that in an era now, in a year especially, with the dynamic duos popping up all over the league, there really isn't a dynamic duo in Toronto. Right? Pascal Siakam has really developed under Nick Nurse especially. He won Most Improved Player of the Year last year, blossomed into an all-star caliber player this year. And Kyle Lowry and him are a pretty good pairing, right? Two all-stars, solid. But let's look at the teams in the bubble. Let's look at the playoff teams in the bubble. Where would you rank the Pascal Siakam-Kyle Lowry duo in the NBA right now? Conservatively, I would say that the Lakers with Anthony Davis and LeBron James are better. The Clippers with Paul George and Kawhi Leonard are better. The Bucks with Chris Middleton and Giannis Antetokounmpo are better. The Mavericks with Luka Doncic and Kristaps Porzingis are better. The Celtics with Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown are better. The Rockets with Russell Westbrook and James Harden are better. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 teams that have a better dynamic duo than the Raptors. So conservatively, and there's a few other teams you can make an argument for, conservatively, the Raptors are dead in the middle in terms of where their stars rank among the playoff teams. But despite that, Nick Nurse has gotten the best out of the entire roster, has elevated the play of the entire roster to where this team is a great team. They are a pain in the butt defensively. They make you really earn it. Transition, they are deadly. Transition offense, they are deadly. So I look at Nick Nurse losing a top 5 player from your team, not addressing it, still winning more than you did when the player was there. He's doing more with less than anyone else in the NBA. He is doing more with less talent than any other coach right now in the NBA. So for me, that is a direct result of being the best coach in the NBA. Anyone can coach talent. I don't want to minimize that. But if I was a coach, let's say, of the Lakers, if I was a coach, let's say, of the Clippers, they'd win some games. Now, I'm not comparing myself to Doc Rivers or Frank Vogel. Don't get me wrong. Those guys have elevated those teams to an even higher level. But just on a bare bones level, when you're more talented than the other team, you're going to win more times than not in the NBA. So Nick Nurse continues to do, getting a group, a team atmosphere together, having them buy in. That's why, to me, I think he's the best coach in the NBA. So I'm buying into Nick Nurse, despite the fact that this is only his second year as a head coach in the NBA. I'm buying it. I think he's the best coach right now in the NBA. Better than Greg Popovich, Steve Kerr, Budenholzer, Doc Rivers, whoever you like. X's and O's, Brad Stevens, if you like the way he draws up offense. Getting the players to play together as a team. Defensive strategist. To me, I like it all. Nick Nurse is my guy. So I'm curious, you. Is Nick Nurse the best coach in the NBA? If not, who is? Love to hear your thoughts again. Worldwide Sports Radio Network on Facebook. WWSR_radio. Shoot us a tweet. Read it on the air. And when we come back, a really bizarre and interesting situation kind of took place over the weekend. Earl Thomas got in a fight, sent home, and now 2 days later, cut by the Ravens. one, it proved one thing that Lamar Jackson was wrong about. And two, there's one aspect of this entire situation that went down. Drives me up a wall. We'll discuss in 3 minutes when the Morning Boys Ryan and Key return right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys. On Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hickey.
And we are back here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. A lot of NBA talk going through, discussing your thoughts on Luka Doncic's just incredible performances so far. The NBA, if it's still a nationally relevant sport, I say yes. The ratings say no. And who's the best coach at the NBA right now? I say Nick Nurse. I love your thoughts. Again, Worldwide Sports Network on Facebook. Comment under the live video that's going on. You want to tweet us at WWSRN underscore radio, WWSRN underscore radio. You want to go right to the source. Tweet me, Ryan underscore Hickey, and the number 3. So get your NBA thoughts before we get out of here at the top of the hour at 11 Eastern. But there's some NFL news that was really bizarre. If you kept an eye on it, kind of just saw the periphery, it was very interesting. And there was two real big takeaways I took from this, and that is that the Ravens decided yesterday to cut Earl Thomas. Their Pro Bowl safety, they signed him to a big four-year, $55 million deal back in 2019, so just a year ago. Biggest deal for a defensive player in Ravens history. Kind of significant when you had, you know, guys like Ray Lewis, guys like Ed Reed there for so long. I know the money's different, but still shocking to hear Earl Thomas, highest paid or biggest contract, I should say, given out to a Ravens defensive player in their history. And made the Pro Bowl last year, a Pro Bowl safety. You know, maybe not a big of an impact interception-wise or pass breakup-wise that he did in the Legion of Boom in Seattle. Well, obviously a little bit older coming off that horrific leg injury, but still a very good player. Again, a Pro Bowl player. And there's two things that I took away from this. One that I got a big Twitter fight over with a few of my Penn State friends, Jeff and Andy, that they think their mind hurts from that argument. My mind hurts. I'll tell you what it is in a second here. But there's one thing I want to get into, actually, that proved Lamar Jackson wrong. And if you know what I'm talking about, a month ago, we discussed when it comes to Antonio Brown, right? To me, I wouldn't take the chance. He is toxic, and I understand the talent is there. It's a Hall of Fame talent at wide receiver. The distractions, the headache he brings isn't worth it. Well, Lamar Jackson thought differently. So about a month ago, Lamar Jackson was talking about and basically advocating for why the Ravens would be a great fit for Antonio Brown. Here's what Lamar said just a month ago.
The locker room here is different from any other locker room. Like, it's a brotherhood going on. It's none of that outside noise. You know, it's strictly inside. Like, we worry about each other. We worry about what we have going on. We want to win. And I just tell in him, he want to win. He want to play ball.
I'm not sure why I was skipping there. I apologize for the audio not being great. But you get the overall message. The locker room can accept Antonio Brown. He can fit into where he won't be a distraction. They'll bring him in the locker room because it's close. It's a real brotherhood. And they are tight-knit. That they won't let Antonio Brown become a distraction the way he was in Pittsburgh, the way he was in Oakland, the way he was in New England. Well, Lamar, I'd love to get your thoughts now, seeing what happened with Earl Thomas, to where Friday, Earl Thomas allegedly misses a blown coverage. The other safety, Chuck Clark, gets upset. Thanks, Earl Thomas, posting the play on his Instagram. We see Chuck Clark slams his helmet down in frustration. And according to reports, according to leaks, the two got into a discussion on the sideline about the missed assignment, and that led to Earl Thomas clocking Clark right in the face. Sent home from practice, told to stay home from practice on Saturday, and then on Sunday, we know, just about noontime, the Ravens decided to cut Earl Thomas, move on from him, take a big cap hit for this year, and just basically cut bait, cut their losses. So I'm curious for Lamar, because if this locker room is such a brotherhood, if they were so close to where they don't allow distractions to enter the locker room, and if so, if the distraction does occur, they can settle it, move on, and, you know, basically just continue to play ball, no problem. Because that's obviously not the case. Couldn't do it with Earl Thomas. From what you see, these are some, and this is obviously not a one-time issue. Because fights happen in training camp. And no one gets cut by him, for the most part, unless you're just a bad player. But no one to the caliber of Earl Thomas gets in a fight and gets cut the next day. But now you start to read articles, reporters getting more details. This isn't the first incident of bad behavior by Earl Thomas that kind of rubbed his teammates the wrong way, got him frustrated. This is in the year plus he's been in Baltimore. He's either missed a bunch of meetings, showed up late to a bunch of meetings. He was said to not listen to the coaches. Now he's had multiple confrontations with teammates. Obviously, Chuck Clark, the latest. Last year, got into an incident with one of the defensive linemen because he didn't suit up for a game and Earl Thomas thought he should have played. So does this sound familiar to you? Missing meetings or showing up late to meetings, not listening to coaches, and getting in multiple confrontations with teammates. Who does that sound like to you? Does it sound like one Antonio Brown? Because guess what? You hear from Pittsburgh, you hear from Oakland, you watch on Hard Knocks. That's essentially the same thing that happened. The great ownership, the great team that the Steelers are, the great culture they have, couldn't contain Antonio Brown. All the veterans that were there, Ben Roethlisberger obviously being a franchise quarterback, couldn't rein in Antonio Brown and get him focused on the field. Tom Brady, the Patriot way, Bill Belichick, couldn't keep Antonio Brown on the straight and narrow. So the locker room, when you hear about Earl Thomas, and this is really being the icing on the cake of him punching a player, Chuck Clark, in the face, this was the straw that broke the camel's back for this locker room. They were fed up, they were frustrated, and they said, screw it. I don't care if this guy's a Pro Bowl player. I don't care how much money you got tied up into him, how much guaranteed money that if we cut him, we're going to be hurting money-wise, cap-wise. That's just going to hurt our flexibility to sign other players. We got to get rid of him. We got to rid ourselves of this guy. And that's what they did. They released him. So I don't see how Earl Thomas, this situation goes down, but you have Lamar Jackson thinking that this locker room can handle Antonio Brown. Now, thankfully, Lamar's kind of been on his own when it comes to advocating for Antonio Brown. And anytime Eric DaCosta or John Harbaugh have been asked about it, they really kind of shut it down, really show no interest. But a star quarterback is advocating for the player, saying the brotherhood's there, the locker room can handle the distractions, it won't become a problem. Well, they couldn't handle Earl Thomas. They cut a Pro Bowl player. And as we know in the NFL, more than any other league, if you can play, if you have talent, a lot of other things will be overlooked. You'd be a bad person off the field. You can get in trouble with the law. If you can play, there's a spot for you. So for the Ravens to cut bait the way they did, coming off a Pro Bowl season, coming off a big contract that was handed to him just a year ago, they said, we're good. So, again, not that I think the Ravens needed this because, again, their front office never really showed legitimate interest. It was more their star quarterback. But I hope Lamar Jackson now realizes the Ravens locker room is just like every other locker room. You're not different. All 32 locker rooms are brotherhood. That's what the NFL is. Football, because of the violence, you need to rely on the guy next to you to know that he is going to do his job. So every locker room is the same. There's all trust there. When it comes to distractions, no locker room is built for Antonio Brown. So I just wanted to kind of, because that really kind of popped in my head, remembering Lamar Jackson saying the Ravens locker room is different. They handle distractions. Well, they couldn't handle Earl Thomas. So that just makes a show. If they can't handle Earl Thomas, who is a different distraction, different kind of drama than Antonio Brown, there's no shot in hell they could handle Antonio Brown. And here's the other thing that kind of, that drove me crazy that got into a big Twitter fight with my guys, Jeff and Andy. And that is this need, and not just by the Ravens, but this happens in all different sports, all different teams. Reports come out that the team, X team, in this case the Ravens, are looking to trade a disgruntled player, in this case Earl Thomas. If they don't get to a trade, they're going to just end up releasing the player. They're going to cut him. And what drives me crazy, what gets me frustrated personally, is that why would you undercut your own leverage? Like, sure, obviously this Earl Thomas situation played out in public. So it's really, you can only do so much in terms of trying to disguise your feelings, disguise your moves. right? Obviously, we know Earl Thomas's future is in doubt and in question in Baltimore. So obviously, teams know you're going to probably try to look to get rid of this player. But why? The thing I don't understand is that say you're going to release him, whether it's leaked through the team, whether it's leaked through the player, whether it's leaked through the player agent, somehow it gets out. The player will be released if they can't find a trade. Why would any team want to trade for that player? You undercut your own leverage. If a team knows you're backed into a corner where it's, all right, if we can't trade him, if you don't give us what we want, you know, we're just going to release the player anyway. So if you're a team that's interested in getting Earl Thomas, why give the Ravens any sort of decent offer, let alone any offer, and then just wait it out, wait for Earl Thomas to be cut, and then go try to, you know, bid it out money-wise? To me, it just hurts the team that's in the position to try to get rid of the player. Right? The NFL, it's all about secrecy. It's all about smoke screens, right? We see, especially with the draft. All these teams are reporting to jump up, to trade down. They like this player. They like that player. It's all smoke screens to try to get what they want. Either trading down, if you're a team up there, they don't like any player. Trading up to get the player you want. It's all a game. It's all a game of deception to get what you want, mislead others in order to try to capitalize. Was it the same thing here? If Earl Thomas is that big of an issue to where the locker room decides, and in part this is the straw that broke the camel's back, they say, you know what, we're done with this guy. He punched Chuck Clark. We like Chuck Clark. We're done with him. Don't bring him back. That's fine and well. You think for the team, for your own leverage sake, you'd say, all right, we're hearing offers for Earl Thomas. We'll keep him if we don't get a good offer. Maybe no offers. Maybe there are no good offers. All right, you tried. You cut him. I just don't get the need to announce you're going to cut a player if you can't find a suitable trade partner. I'll compare it to this, because this actually popped in my head this morning. Back, you know, middle school, high school, remember the good old days? You had lunch before coronavirus. Go in the lunchroom, see what's in, you know, see what mom packed for lunch that day. What if you open up your lunchbox? For me, I'm a big peanut butter and jelly fan. What if there was a tuna fish sandwich in there? Like, oh, tuna fish. I'm not eating this crap. No, thank you. And all of a sudden, what do? You don't throw it out. You don't announce to the world, oh, this tuna fish sandwich is gross. Who wants it? You say, hey, anyone up for a trade? Anyone, you know, anyone down to, you know, anyone in the market for a tuna fish sandwich? I have a tuna fish sandwich here. I'm listening to offers. You know, I see you got some pretzels over there. I see you got some marshmallows. I see you have a peanut butter and jelly over there. Anyone in the market to, you know, do a little trade? Especially in elementary school. You see it a lot. It was a big deal, a lot of fun, trading snacks. What can you upgrade? What can you get for what? Now, if I was in the market, if I didn't want the tuna fish sandwich, and I knew, worst case scenario, no one gave me a trade, or no one would want to trade their food, then I would just end up not eating it, basically throw it in the middle of the table so whoever wants it can have it. Why would I say that right away? Because if I was anyone else, I'd be like, oh, I'll just wait for him to toss it. He's not going to eat it. So sure, maybe, you know, I have pretzels. I could give him the pretzels that I have, but, you know, I could also keep the pretzels, and when I know that no one else wants to trade for the tuna fish sandwich, I'll take the tuna fish sandwich. Just undercutting your own leverage. That's all. So that was just, and again, the Ravens aren't the only team, so I'm not just putting this squarely on the Ravens' shoulders, but it's also more frustrating that teams undercut, whether leaked by their sources or not, because sometimes you can't control it. But you figure, and especially in the NFL, there's so much secrecy going on. It's all a game of leverage, all about trying to get one over on the other guy. Why you would announce or why you would want any, you know, why you would try your best, I should say, to keep it from coming out. You're going to cut the player if you can't find a deal. So that was one of my biggest things that I guess, Jeff, Andy, if you're listening, I have no clue. That's what drove me crazy. They seem to very much disagree. Very much disagree. But hey, that's, again, I don't get it. I honestly don't get it. You can try your best. You can try to trade him. You can say you're going to keep him and then in the end cut him. If you're going to get to the same result anyway, I don't get why I have to tell everyone, hey, we're going to cut him if we can't find a trade partner. Because guess what? If I'm the other team, if I'm listening, I'm not giving you a best offer. I might not even give you any offer. See if you can get him on the cheap. See if you can get him for a lot less without giving up anything. So I'm curious your thoughts. You see Earl Thomas, someone who's, first of all, not his only run in this offseason or this year. He had his wife hold a loaded gun to his head earlier this year because she thought he was cheating with his brother, with another girl. So Earl Thomas, you know, again, one for distractions, we'll say. One to make not the best judgments, we'll say. But now he punches his teammate, gets cut. Would you want to play like this? Would you want to play like Earl Thomas on your team? Get your thoughts. And when we come back, we'll finish up with this. Philadelphia, the 76ers swept by the Boston Celtics. Another year of the process really not coming to fruition. I want to discuss why the process, led by Sam Hinkie, they did the easy thing. Philly got the easy part done. But there's one fatal flaw they overlooked. That they have not been able, and that's keeping them, I should say, from being a championship-level team. We'll tell you what that is when the Morning Boys Reineke return right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. It's time to wake up with the Morning Boys on Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And here's your host, Ryan Hinkie.
His birthday was yesterday, so it only pays tribute on 8/24 to wish Kobe Bryant a happy birthday. And again, obviously gone way, way, way too soon. Really the first incident they got 2020. It gave us some sort of idea how brutal 2020 was going to be. But one day later, happy birthday, Kobe. Again, 8/24. Obviously, it's two numbers. We definitely gone, but not forgotten, that is for sure. So wish Kobe Bryant a happy birthday, or a belated birthday, I should say. Talking a lot of Earl Thomas, and really one aspect that just drove me crazy was that they hurt their own leverage. Sorry. I was so frustrated last night. I forgot what I said. They hurt their own leverage with saying we're going to cut the player if we can't find a trade. They ended up cutting him a few hours later anyway. Who knows what they could have gotten back, but to me, something's better than nothing. Some teams out there, there's too much talent, again, to not take a chance and trade for Earl Thomas. But Ravens are just done, cut him. To me, this proves Lamar Jackson was wrong, that the fact that he believes that Antonio Brown would fit in this locker room, that this locker room could handle a distraction like Antonio Brown. Not the case. And no real need or concern too much because the front office of the Ravens is never truly thinking about it. But if you're a Ravens fan that wanted Antonio Brown, I hope this shows what could have been. And you're taking a sigh of relief that you didn't end up signing him and don't end up signing Antonio Brown. So get your thoughts, Facebook, Twitter, before we get out of here, about 15 minutes or so. But I do want to finish on one last NBA note, at least for today's show. And that is, you know, we talked about the greatness of Luka Doncic. Talked about the greatness of Nick Nurse so far in his 2 years as a head coach. I believe he's the best head coach right now in the NBA. Can we talk some negativity? I do want to talk about what happens when you don't achieve greatness. The other side of greatness, right? That is the losing team. That is a team that falls victim. And one of those teams is the Philadelphia 76ers. Get swept by the Boston Celtics. Obviously, they didn't have Ben Simmons. But this disastrous year of Jekyll and Hyde, yin and yang, great at home, terrible on the road, couldn't really figure out what the hell they were trying to do with their roster construction. 2019-2020 year, a year that came in with hype. Obviously, they lose. Is that heartbreaking series last year to the Raptors where Kawhi Leonard, that ball that bounces five times on the rim before it drops in to eliminate the Sixers at the buzzer. Obviously, heartbreaking. Kawhi leaves. And also in the Eastern Conference, okay, it could be vulnerable. But instead, Philly play their way to a six seed. Good morning, good afternoon, good night. Swept out of the bubble by the Celtics. And now they are scrambling to pick up the pieces. And this is probably going to end in Brett Brown's firing, I should say. He's going to lose his job. And a lot of questions surround the roster going into 2020-2021 season. And I want to take a look back on the process itself. because it's not, I wouldn't close the book on itself, on the process itself yet. Obviously, you would assume they're going to keep and or Ben Simmons and Joel Embiid, probably both, heading to 2020, 2021. But I more kind of want to highlight just the overall thought process of tanking and why trying to win is hell of a lot harder than it really you really think about. So again, the process, obviously, Sam Hinkie, 2013, gets there, and his thought process is we're going to lose as many games as possible for 3-4 years, accumulate as many lottery balls, as many draft picks as we possibly can, and just by numbers, just by percentage, we're going to hit on a few guys. That talent alone should carry us and make us back into title contenders, put us in the upper echelon of the Eastern Conference and the NBA, and bring a Larry O'Brien trophy back to Philadelphia. Now, they did the easy part. Sam Hinkie accomplished the easy part, and that is accumulating talent. They lost, and they did some more losing. Since 2013, when the process really first went underway, they accumulated 17 draft picks since then. Obviously, you hit on Joel Embiid, hit on Ben Simmons. But the easy part is losing on purpose. The easy part is getting high up in the lottery. And this was even before the lottery was started, earlier, you know, in the early years of the process. So getting that top pick was easier than ever. So the easy part in the process was losing. Losing, they did a ton of it. Again, they got Embiid, they got Simmons. Here's what the hard part that I think Philly either didn't think of that was that hard, didn't really think to that was the next step, or try but couldn't do it, and this just shows how hard winning is. And that is putting these players in positions to win. If you just think about it, going from a losing culture to where you may not say you're trying to lose on purpose, but you're doing everything possible to lose on purpose, it's not easy as just snapping your fingers and going from, all right, guys, we're going to lose games to let's go win games. Let's go out there. Let's try. We got Embiid. We got Simmons. We like the young nucleus that we got. You know what? This is the year we're going to turn around. We're going to start trying to win. It doesn't work like that. You can't go from perpetual losing, from basically being applauded for losing. Think about it. The Sixers fans themselves saw the vision, embraced the losing, and were rooting for losses. So you have a fan base that basically inverted their brain to root for losing, to accept losing. And meanwhile, everyone thought, snap the finger, all right, this is the year we're going to start winning. We're going to do it. It's going to be easy. It's not easy. Because as we've seen, getting the players, getting the draft picks, doesn't guarantee anything. Getting Embiid, getting Simmons on the same team doesn't guarantee your success, you winning a title, if you don't have a winning philosophy and you don't know how to construct a roster. Think about it now. Simmons and Embiid, similar strengths, right? Both great in the paint, great at the rim. Embiid, obviously, a big man. He's versatile. He can go out and shoot threes. He's athletic. He makes plays around the rim. Ben Simmons, his strengths, driving to the hole, creating, getting that downhill head of speed and attacking the rim, drawing fouls, getting to the rim, using his size and ball handling ability to make plays within 15 or so feet from the rim. So, okay, you have two guys that thrive down low. Let's put a few three-point shooters and we'll go. We'll go after it. But Philly doesn't do that. They either refused to see or know the strengths of their two best players or thought that they would evolve and develop a skill set that they didn't already have just because they're great players. So instead of getting, you know, let's say a Kyle Korver type of player, wing player, shoot threes, you had J.J. Redick there, you lose him. They instead try to surround Embiid and Simmons with Al Horford, Tobias Harris, neither of which are known for spreading the floor dynamically. Both of whom, along with Simmons and Embiid, really clogged the paint. So teams playing defense basically had to guard 15 feet and in for the Sixers. And they tried to play a different style of basketball, bully ball, like it was played in the 80s and the 90s. In an era where spacing is prominent, three-point shooting is key, and playing again, keep like creating space. That's how you win the NBA today. Sixers, as I said, try to basically go backwards in time and shows it doesn't work. If you don't know how to construct a roster, it doesn't work. Whether it was Sam Hinkie, whether it was Brian Colangelo before he started tweeting from burner accounts, and now it's Elton Brand. Elton Brand especially, because he's the one who put this roster together, the most recent edition of it. And you look at this roster currently, with four guys whose skills best suit them from 17 feet in. You have Tobias Harris on the hook for four more years, basically $150 million. Al Horford on the hook, three more years, $81 million. Ben Simmons, his extension of 5 years, $177 million, kicks in next year. And you have Embiid for three more years. So the four guys with similar skill sets, with similar strengths, are all on the hook for the next at least 3 years with a ton of money. So it's going to take a lot of craftiness, a lot of work to dig out of this hole that Elton Brand and the Sixers created for themselves because they didn't know how to build a roster. Not to mention, we talk about, you know, building a winning culture. The philosophy of the team, of the organization, did not match the roster they had. I love this quote by Brett Brown that I want to go back to that he made on December 7th. Why is that date significant, I should say? Ben Simmons, as we know, not only struggles from the three-point line, just refuses to take threes. Doesn't even try. At least for a player like Giannis, who doesn't shoot for a high clip, he shoots. And he shoots enough to where teams have to at least come out more than they would basically just dare him to take the three-point shot. So you know he's missing shots. He opens up the floor for himself because teams have to guard and respect that he'll pull up and shoot a three. Ben Simmons just refuses to do so. He has only one plan in his mind. He's going to drive and attack. And that's it. So December 7th, Ben Simmons takes and makes a three-pointer. After the game, Brett Brown pleaded with Ben Simmons, with his family, with his agent to incorporate a three-point shot into his game. Brett Brown said he expects minimum one three-point attempt per every game going forward. That was on December 7th. Let's fast forward to where we are right now, August 24th, 2020. Do you know how many three-pointers Ben Simmons took since December 7th? Since Brett Brown basically tried to mandate Ben Simmons take one three-pointer per game. Good or not, just take one. Do you know how many threes Ben Simmons attempted the rest of the season? Three. 0-for-3. So the philosophy of Brett Brown sees the way the NBA is trying to spread out the floor, trying to help guys like Embiid down low by having Simmons shoot more from the outside. The philosophy is not there. No one's on the same page. Because Ben Simmons basically blew it off, took three more threes the entire season, basically said, screw it, I'm just going to do my own game. Forget the fact that it hurts the team. Forget the fact that it makes it easier to defend both Embiid and Simmons, especially when it comes to the playoffs. The philosophy is not there. Embiid, since he first started with Philly, always issues, first of all, getting injured, and then staying in shape. His diet, his fitness, never really where it should be. So Brett Brown never really had control of the locker room. His voice never was meaningful. And this is the hard part of the process that I don't think Sam Hinkie, when he first started, when the Philly fans adopted and the 76ers organization, I should say, kind of took over. I mean, a little less egregious aspect when he resigned, but still kind of tried to implement it and carry forward, was that this is why tanking is so hard to do, and it's anything but a guarantee. Because it is easy to lose games. It is easy to get high in the lottery year after year after year. And it's easy, too, to hit on a few draft picks when you have, it feels like a million bullets. Again, 17 draft picks since 2013. A lot of misses. A lot of misses in that time. But you have to hit on a few gems. Percentage-wise, you're going to hit. If you have enough shots, you're going to hit. So they hit. Now, if they drafted a little bit better, imagine where they could be. And you take Jason Tatum instead of Markelle Fultz, this may be a different conversation. That's also part of it. That's the hard part that Philly never was able to get over the hump for. Player evaluation, roster development, player development. It's overall straight up player development. Once you get the talent, how can you make that player into an even better player than they were in college or in high school or overseas, wherever they played? I don't know if the 76ers just thought that talent, like you draft a player and that's how it's going to turn around. It's sort of like the Knicks philosophy, but instead of with the draft, the Knicks think it's free agency. You get one player and all of a sudden they're going to be this 60-win team, this team that you really got to fear now. But it's like it's similar philosophies. Okay, we drafted the player. We'll sit back now and let's just relax. That's not how it works. It's truly hard to win. So I'm not sure, again, whether it's now Elton Brand, who's currently the general manager of the Sixers, thinking that, all right, no matter who I put here, we'll get Al Horford, we'll re-sign Tobias Harris, we'll let Jimmy Butler go down to Miami. Who cares if the skill set is similar? You know, we'll figure it. They'll be okay. Talent wins out in the end. Talent wins out. Yeah, but if you have a roster that doesn't complement the skills of your two cornerstone players, if you have players that do the same thing, it's easy to defend. It doesn't work. If you don't have a philosophy that the players buy into, that is organizationally the pillars that you want to kind of have your team carry out, you're in the same spot as the Sixers, which honestly is even worse than when they started tanking. Being stuck in the middle is the worst place to be. You're not bad enough to get a game-changing player. You're not good enough to really compete with the big boys. And now the cap's going to be hamstrung. With all this money and all these big deals you gave these players with similar skill sets. And they have failed to put these players in positions to succeed. Brett Brown had an impossible job. He tried his best. He tried to space Ben Simmons out, use him as the guy to open up the floor for guys like Al Horford, for guys like Tobias Harris, for guys like Joel Embiid, and just Ben Simmons refused to do so. Refused it. I'm not listening to Brett Brown. I'm doing my own thing. The buy-in wasn't there. That's an organizational flaw on the Sixers. So they did the easy part. They lost. You got the assets. You got the draft picks. You hit on Embiid. You hit on Simmons. It doesn't end there. That's just the beginning. That's where the hard part actually starts. And so far for the process, it feels like their entire mission was just, all right, once you get the draft picks, once we hit, we're done. The rest will, you know, the talent will take over from there. That's not the case. That's just the beginning. The Sixers and the process thought it was the end. So Philly's going to have a lot of questions, a lot of reshuffling, because I don't see how they're any way are able to go forward with this roster again next year, run it back again, and expect different results. So we'll see. It's going to be a very, very, very interesting offseason in Philly. Again, expect the first move being Brett Brown relieved of his duties. And we will see, will one player, will two players be on the move going elsewhere? It's going to be a very interesting offseason to watch coming out of Philadelphia. So that's going to do it for this edition and the final edition of the Morning Boys. Again, we will not be here on Thursday. One last soiree before summer concludes. So we'll be back here a week from today, a week from Monday, August 31st, to close out the month. And we'll be under a new name, the Ryan Hickey Show. So you want to follow us on Twitter, at Ryan Hickey Show. Follow us on Instagram, at Ryan Hickey Show. Same thing. So Twitter and Instagram, same thing, at Ryan Hickey Show. Have a lot of behind the scenes, instant reaction. It's a lot more engagement on social media than really I've been doing the past few months or so. So I'm very, very, very excited. Week from today, same time, same place, Worldwide Sports Radio Network. The only thing that's changing is the name. So instead of the Morning Boys, it'll be the Ryan Hickey Show. But very, very, very excited for that to debut a week from Monday. So that said, since I won't talk to you, have a great rest of your week. Stay safe, stay sane, enjoy your weekend. We'll see you on Monday right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Radio Network.